It's time for Mac Break Weekly. Renee, Andy, and Alex are here. We've got a big show. Lots to talk about. Does iTunes delete your music? We'll explain what might have happened and how to avoid it. Plus, talk about the latest rumors about Macintoshes and iPhones. WWDC's coming up. What can we expect there? It's all ahead on Mac Break Week.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for MacBreak Weekly is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is MacBreak Weekly, episode 506, recorded Tuesday, May 10th, 2016. Music is hard. MacBreak Weekly is brought to you by Rocket Mortgage by Quicken Loans. Rocket Mortgage brings the mortgage process into the 21st century with a fast, easy, and completely online process. Check out Rocket Mortgage today at quickenloans.com/MacBreak. And by Gazelle, the online marketplace for buying and selling used gadgets. Shop from a variety of certified pre-owned electronics or trade one in for cash. Give new life to a used device at gazelle.com today. And by Trunk Club. Get clothes that fit and look amazing without ever stepping into a store again. Trunk Club will help you create the wardrobe you've always dreamed of with your own personal stylist. Go to trunkclub.com/MacBreak and join Trunk Club today. It's time for Mac Break Weekly, the show where we cover the latest news from Apple with some of the best people in the Apple biz, Andy Inoko, of course. We're going to call him Auntie Inoko today from the Chicago Sun-Times.
I have some hard butterscotch candy. All for you.
He's got a some sort of Raspberry Pi project on the floor there over to his left. I don't know what that is.
Oh, I've got a couple. That was my... Every time when I'm in Toys R Us and I see a toy that can be activated by, sometimes they have those demo switches, like their lights and sounds like activate stuff, and they have a demo switch, like if you press it, then like the Wall-E toy will go through its like little motions and stuff. If I've got 20 or 30 bucks to spend, I will buy it because those are the easiest thing to wire up to an Arduino or a Raspberry Pi. So I have, that's my Eve toy, and she's, I've already unplugged her, but.
She was cheap.
Well, no. See, again, so you can easily like tap into like those wires neat. In the back, and if she's in demo mode like that, try me mode, then she goes like. So I can either like when I've got an Arduino project that lights up an LED to let people know that Bluetooth has been enabled or that yes, the file job has been done. I can, instead of having an LED fire up, have just be in the other room and hear. Think, oh, I guess I need to go and check the paper on the tray because Eve is telling me that
it's no Toots the Magic Unicorn, but that's pretty awesome.
I try not to encourage farting in the office.
I have purchased Toots the Magic Unicorn for a great amount of money. Whenever I think when people donate money, we're gonna have it. Kind of. This is an Indiegogo. They came by the studio on the Sunday, and I fell for it. I am such a sucker for Kickstarters and
for Twitter, Twitch,
and so you can tie it up to your Twitter. Or I'll use if this and that.
Just tell me what matters most to you, and I'll do
what. What a humiliating thing, though. If they actually ship this, and then you look at all the other Kickstarter projects that were like, this is a stationary drone that could be used for security and surveillance. Did not ship, but the farting magical unicorn shipped.
I think it's going to ship.
You actually got your money back for
it. We call that logistics management.
That's Alex Lindsay from the Pixicorn, knows a lot about logistics. He manages big, giant trunks of gear. I've never seen such massive gear trunks, Pelican cases. Hello, Alex.
Hello.
Are you in where's your locale this
time? I'm just a little south, but I was managing a stream this morning from here, so I couldn't get out of the office, but I'm just down in San Rafael.
Cool. I have a stream question for you, but first let's also welcome Renee Ritchie of iMore.com. Hello, Renee.
Good morning, Leo. I'm thrilled to be here.
Now, three out of the four of us have bicycles because you just got a bicycle.
I did. I was motivated by you and Andy. I had to join the club.
Yeah, I bicycled to work today.
I have a bicycle, but don't go nowhere.
You don't have time for bicycling.
It's like a computer for the legs.
I have a bicycle, but if it went somewhere, I couldn't watch TV while I was biking. So I just have it just stay in the garage.
That's a nice play on the Steve Jobs. It's a which the Apple computer was a bicycle for the mind. Bicycle is a computer for your legs. Renee, you got to explain to me what's going on. James Pinkhouse, is that his name, from Vellum?
Oh, God.
Well, but he joins the Jim Dalrymple crew. He wrote a blog post saying Apple has Apple Music has deleted my Pinkstone, I think is his name, has deleted my music. Pinkstone stole my music, he said. I think that's maybe a little bit inflammatory. He claims he called to somebody named Amber, who says the software is functioning as intended. We don't really know who Amber is.
This is why Serenity Caldwell's week last week erupted into fire and flame.
Well, I want to say that I would not rush to judgment on Mr. Pinkstone because, you know, this is very similar to what Jim Dalrymple reported.
Yeah, so, I mean, the problem is that it is overly it is trying to do too much. It is one of those apps that Apple decided to give an impossible job by putting it, you know, from the announcement, we're going to put every one coherent thought around music, but they forgot the coherent part. So it's just all different types of music crammed into one interface in a way that is absolutely impenetrable to most people. And what's going on here is...
But you're saying it's user error, not...
Well, but I mean, Apple's not helping people here. So with Jim, he tried Apple Music. He decided he didn't like it. So he flipped off the iCloud Music library, knowing Jim probably in several ways, flipping it off, assuming that would turn off Apple Music. But it also turned off iCloud iTunes Match, which Jim really liked and was the way that he was syncing his music between devices. Oh. So that music all disappeared. And the switch wasn't labeled in any way. It just said iCloud Music library. Turned it off. Everything was gone. He thought
so that
music
turns
was
off. Match.
It turns off everything. They conflated the two because they built a version of Match into Apple Music. So the whole thing is very confusing. So Jim went to Apple. They flipped the switch back on. I think almost all his music was back. So he was really happy about it. But, you know, if that's happening to Jim, imagine what's happening to a lot of people.
You're talking about Jim Dalrymple here.
Absolutely. From The Loop.
And so Jim Dalrymple has said now, okay, everything's okay. He's over it. Okay, good. All right.
Well, he still has frustration. He has a lot of frustrations, but that particular one.
I haven't heard that part. So let me read from James Pinkstone's blog post, and actually I'm going to read the salient paragraph. When I signed up for Apple Music, iTunes evaluated my massive collection of MP3s and WAV files, scanned the Apple database for what it considered matches, then this is the thing I'm curious about, then removed the original files from my internal hard drive. Now, it's not been my experience that that's what happens. But he's saying, and because he's a composer, a lot of the WAV files are not stuff that was in Apple's database. But worse, he has, and I think this does happen, mismatched music. He had a Fountains of Wayne song that there was a single of, but he had a rare early version of it. And, of course, Match said, oh, no, it's the single. Now what he's saying is that the original was removed from his internal hard drive and replaced with the single, which is not the same version.
Yeah, so I mean,
he also says he has a backup, so don't nothing to freak out about. But this could be a real warning. I want to make sure people understand what's going on here.
It is super confusing, but what happens is if you were, my belief is that Apple should simplify this and they should realize that there are a bunch of people who have incredibly curated music collections and just stay away from them because they've been managing their music for years and there's no reason to interfere with that. You can offer Apple Music as a separate service that doesn't sort of conflate with people's own collections where people like Jim might want 10 different versions of the same Megadeth song and be able to access them whenever they want. That's something totally different. But here what happens is when they do the initial matching, they take all the music that's on your primary computer. That's the computer that has your library that you start Apple Music on. And it checks those. And if it has a higher quality copy, it quote unquote replaces it with the version from Apple Music. But because Apple Music isn't your music, it's not music that you're matching and storing on the cloud. It's music that you have access to everywhere. All of that is DRM'd. So because if you turn off iCloud, Apple Music, you lose those things. Now, that should not touch anything on your
Wait
primary
a minute.
computer.
So it's adding DRM?
So I'm explaining this poorly, but if you have, let's say you have MacBook number one and you have all your music on it and you subscribe to Apple Music, you will have access to all those songs on Mac number two, even if you didn't transfer them. You'll just be able to access them through Apple Music.
That's kind of like Match.
DRM streaming copies.
But it's different with music than it is with Match, because music has to somehow, music has to somehow turn off those songs if you don't continue to subscribe.
Absolutely. And Match is separate. Match you pay $25 for, and it will actually match your songs and let you download DRM-free copies of those songs. It's saying, okay, we know you own those. We verified them. Apple Music is just saying, okay, we don't have this in our catalog, but we see that you do, and it's also in the iTunes catalog, or we managed to upload it, and we'll let you stream it everywhere. And because you have the ability to bookmark and quote-unquote download that music, it's just putting shadow copies of what exists on the Apple Music library. And if you turn off Apple Music or you unsubscribe, all that vanishes. So you might think that Mac 2 has all your music on it, but it really has all Apple Music on it. And then you turn that off, that's gone. The problem occurs when people think, oh, great, everything's in Apple Music now. I don't need my local copies anymore. I can bring
back. That's the big mistake. Don't ever, ever do that. But that's then you deleting. Now, here's a Serenity, by the way, read a series of articles. She spent a week on this. But the original article was saying, no, they're not deleting your music. But this is what Jason Snell tweeted her. And I think he says, my theory is this dialog box is causing a misunderstanding of what happens next. And boy, if you read this dialog box, it reminds me of the dialog boxes I see in photos that are so confusing and don't give you an option that makes sense. And I have lost photos and photos. Fortunately, I don't rely on photos for backup. Are you sure you want to delete this song? This will delete this song from your iCloud music library and from your other devices. To keep this song in your library and on your other devices, you can remove this download instead. And then it gives you three buttons: remove, download, cancel, and the default is delete song.
And it's impenetrable.
What the hell? So what happens if I click delete song? It's going to delete it everywhere.
Or move it to your trash. So it doesn't delete anything. It will
move it to your trash.
If you have a physical copy on your hard drive, it will move it to the trash.
Okay. And that would include the original Fountains of Wayne song, for instance.
Yeah, if that was your primary computer, and it doesn't have a way of differentiating that file from anything
else. What happens if I say remove download? It doesn't delete anything on my hard drive.
Yeah, no, it basically unchecks it and says no longer download. What they're using download to mean is cache. Keep a local copy cached of the Apple Music file, which is a streaming music file. And again, it's just all way too complicated. And you get, like with the new Apple TV and people using apps, you know, that stream their own collections, they have the same sort of problem. It's the idea of streaming and your local content living together in harmony is beautiful, but it's just not being realized. And when it is being realized, it's done in such a confusing way that my preference would be for Apple to just never touch the data on your disk. If they want, they can make some sort of unified view, like a synergy for music, where they have a data layer abstraction that's, you know, these are pointers. This is pointing to your music. This is pointing to Apple Music. We are never touching your music. It is kept in Apple Music library, sorry, in iTunes library. This is kept in Apple Music library, and we will never, ever, not ever touch this, but we will give you access to all these things. But instead, what they do is they sort of, again, in an effort to make it simple that ends up in complexity, they just want you to think music is music everywhere. And that sounds great on a PowerPoint, even if it's poorly presented, but in actuality, it's turning into something really confusing for a lot of customers.
Actually, in fact, I think you're confused, because if you choose remove download, according to Serenity, it will send the local file, not delete song, remove download will send the local file from your hard drive to your trash, but the XML file will still have a reference. So you can stream it, but you will have the original moved to the trash. That's remove download. What is deletes? So you had it reversed too. So
I thought delete was the one that moves into the trash.
I know. So there you go. And Proteus in our chat room says, as a developer, this dialogue makes me very sad.
Yeah. It's a very sad dialogue. It's almost as sad as a more button in Apple Music.app.
This is why sometimes I think that you can make things easier by actually making them more complicated. That if Apple had separate apps for local music playing and then said, here is our service where you get all the free music, or excuse me, all the music you can eat for just this one subscription fee, and we'll keep this in a separate library, safe from your iTunes library, no one would be having this sort of confusion. This is why I don't think that Amazon's music app is perfection, but I do like the fact that there is an A-B switch. It's like, do you want, if you flip this switch that's right front and center, you are looking at music that is actually stored on this device and actually stored in this local music library. And if you flip it the other way, you're looking at music that you've got, you're playing through and streaming through the cloud, which is, I've never had confusion on that app about where my music is coming from. And it has never screwed up my local library.
Or just don't use Apple Music, use some other service, and then they won't be mixed together.
That's a solution. That's not a solution I think that Apple would love to.
No, I know.
Congratulations.
But as a user, that's a solution.
Yeah, exactly.
A lot of people say, I've never had this problem because I'm not using Apple Music. I mean, it solves the problem.
Well, I use Apple Music all the time, but I don't have a library, so I don't have this problem either. It's really trying to mix the new generation of streaming with the old generation of library. And it's one of those rare cases where, I mean, Apple has opinions on everything. People are constantly upset that Apple doesn't give them more choice, that they make really hard choices for the consumer. In this case, it just feels like total abdication. They just said, people have all these different use cases. We'll do our best to cater to all of them. Good luck with that. Instead of saying, this is what you can do in Apple Music, and this is what we think is the best way to handle your music today.
Yeah. Well, and I have to admit, I didn't even use the Music Match because I was too paranoid of letting Apple fiddle with my...
There was a question mark, I remember, and I don't know if we ever satisfactorily answered it, when Apple Music came out about how this interrelates with iTunes Match. And I think that's... The question never really was answered.
If you pay for it, you get the DRM-free copy is basically what it comes down to. If you pay the extra $25, it will match your music and give you the DRM-free copy on all of your devices. Otherwise, it'll match your music, but it'll do it through the streaming Apple Music library.
So if you as I do, iTunes Match.
Yes.
And you sign up for Apple Music, does that turn Match off?
No, you have both. And they basically, this is again why it's super confusing. Maybe they should have just canceled the Match service or made it separate or not built it. Serenity had a really good article about how Apple should not have included Match in Apple Music because it makes it confusing, because now you have the quote unquote DRM'd Match for Apple Music and you have the non-DRM'd Match from the original. And it takes someone like Serenity this many articles and this long to explain this stuff, to me, shows that there's a lack of coherence at the foundations of this service.
Well, and I think in a lot of ways, you could have your iTunes just not interact with Apple Music at all. And just, it is your collection of the stuff that you have. Now, you could say, hey, look at what I have in here and put it into Apple Music that's going to operate on my phone and maybe even a separate application. But the physical stuff, I think in many ways, I agree that it should have been just left behind, you know, and left alone, rather than trying to integrate it all. I think that's where, and this is not the only thing that's been an issue. I mean, I think that this whole integration has been kind of an ongoing issue since they started the Match process.
You know,
we've seen hits like this.
I think this isn't making it more, to do it right would not be making it more complex, Renee. It would actually be kind of being true to what the old Unix philosophy is, do one thing and do one thing well.
Oh, I
and
agree,
then have
completely.
Applications, it you know, pipe yeah, one to the other. And so you would know what each application did, and its effects would be discrete to that application. There wouldn't be interaction between applications.
And use extensibility to bridge you from one to the
other. Right. I think that's the philosophy that we have in many ways drifted away from. Even Linux has started to drift away from it. And it really makes a lot of sense.
I was looking back at some old stuff and looking at iSync, for instance, the iSync app, which I think is time to bring that app back. It's time to really split up iTunes into four or five different apps, each with its own interface that's absolutely laser fine-tuned to the one task it's meant to do. That one task being everything that's related to local music and media library management, one app that's laser focused on giving the best store experience, one app that's laser focused on simply moving media and other photos to phones and tablets and iCloud and other devices. We've had this redesign in iTunes for years, and I still have that, like, I've got the mouse in my hand. I'm always have that at least 4 seconds of when I'm trying to figure out how I want to shop for an iOS app. Am I in the library now or in the, I get there, but the fact that it's my general rule of thumb is that I'm an idiot the first two or three times I don't get something. The fourth and subsequent times I don't get it, that's just bad design.
Well, and the question is how much is the average person actually interacting on their computer? I was trying to think of the last time I was listening to music off of my laptop, and I couldn't remember. I couldn't remember when that was. It might have been years. I mean,
how do you listen? You listen on your phone?
I listen. My phone is like my phone is pretty much the only place I listen to my music.
And yeah, I have so really good speakers on my computer, and I rarely listen. Yeah.
I mean, I listen to it. I pipe it to a speaker, an external speaker, or I listen to it on headphones. I rarely listen to it actually coming out of the phone. But I think that I don't really use my computer anymore for that. That's crazy because you want to be able to do whatever you're doing on a computer and not have it playing in the background either.
Well, but that's a sad trajectory. I mean, I've been observing where the 10 years ago, maybe my Macs and my Apple devices were just flat out great devices. Then there came this evolution where they're great, but they're particularly great reserved. The great experience is reserved for if you mostly or exclusively use Apple hardware and services working with each other. And now it almost with Apple Music, it's like it's great so long as you're only using Macs with iOS devices, and so long as you're only getting stuff from the Apple Store ever, and you don't try to bring in music files that did not originate from the iTunes Store. We shouldn't overlook the fact that Apple Music, I think, works great for people who are new out of the box users who are like that. I mean, they're, especially if you're 11, 12, 13 years old and you never steal music from anywhere, and you decided that Apple Music is a great place to get your music from. But this is not playing the game at expert level. This is playing the game at maybe moderate level, maybe easy level. And that wouldn't be such a bad problem if not for the fact that there are other music services and there are other platforms that are playing the game at hard and even expert level, and they're actually succeeding.
Well, the question is what percentage of the users are expert level? I mean, I firmly believe that Apple.
I'm not saying expert level users. I'm talking about as a provider of a music service, as the provider of an operating system, as the provider of the hardware. Do you want to do this so well that it just plain works, or are you going to do it the easy way, which is that so long as people can easily sync music from a Mac to an iPhone, actually even better, so long as they never actually use the service on the Mac, they're just getting stuff strictly through Apple Music and strictly through this phone, that's good enough. So it's the people who are creating these services have to play the game at expert level. The users, of course, have to be able to play it at easy level. So I'm not saying that these are experts who want to do this.
I guess I would, and the data that we don't have is how many people are accessing their music via their iOS device or their Mac. And if Apple is looking at data that says that 99% or 98% of the people are accessing it through their iOS, we can see how we might not get a lot of love when it comes to updating.
Again,
I don't know if that's the case, but I'm just saying that.
That's not the ideal. It's not aspirational. We do not want to drive an Apple car that says, we figure that most people, there are very few people who live in snowy times, snowy climates, and most of them will already have a four-wheel drive vehicle. So, it's really hard to create a traction system that actually can handle road salt, a body that can handle road salt and a slippery road condition. So we're just going to target our car towards people who don't drive on non-dry roads when it's 80 degrees outside.
This is sort of why I mentioned earlier that iTunes has an impossible job. And I think Eddie Q hinted at that in one of the interviews where, someone pointed out that you've torn down all these apps. You've torn down Final Cut. You've torn down iMovie. You've torn down, all these apps and built them up iWork. And people were super upset that they lost features, but now you have a modern code base to build on. And why have you done this with iTunes? And he sort of hinted at the fact that iTunes is cross-platform, supported by Windows. There are all these people. They're still selling iPods that have to rely on syncing through iTunes and doing all this functionality, and they're selling them now, so they have to support these people, and it becomes Apple's first real Windows problem, where they have to support an entire, a very, very large ecosystem of people with a very, very different set of use cases. And going back to it, there was a simpler version of Apple Music. There was a much simpler version of Apple Music, but after it was iterated on, it was like, well, we need to add this, we need to add this, and it turned into the monstrosity we have now. And Apple, at least according to Q, is working on managing this transition away from iTunes and towards the future, and that's why they built out separate apps.
Is this what we're going to see at WWDC? The rumors that there'll be a revamped iTunes, or will it be a minor revamp?
It'll be a meaty. I guess it depends on what scale we grade these on. It's going to be a redesign, but it's still part of this long migration where they need to actually get, this is why they spun out a bunch of apps and made them separate on iOS, and why they've done things like making the streaming services so that they could reduce dependency on that native application. But I think it's still going to take a while. I just don't think Apple is experienced in managing this sort of huge legacy transition, and it's showing, especially when you're dealing with the services team, which, you know, this is not Craig Federighi's org making an app with a small group of people who only has one focus on this app. This is everyone managing the expectations of content creators who want to make sure that, you know, there's billions and billions of dollars of transactions going through iTunes too, and you've got to pay for that song, move that song onto the computer, move that song onto the iPod on Windows, and have all of that managed in a fashion that doesn't break. It is literally rebuilding the airplane while it is in the sky. And I don't think Apple has done a particularly great job of it. I obviously couldn't do a better one, but I think we'll continue to see these step-by-step improvements until they finally, until like Apple.com, when the new store went live, they'll flip a switch and we'll see a new version.
Yeah, see, that's part of the difficulty, that if Apple is going to evolve, they really have to figure out how they can solve problems like these, because they've done an exemplary job shifting over to Mac for a sec. They've done an exemplary job developing a computer that 8% of the world uses and loves. They've never had experience trying to solve the problems of what if you have to make computers for everybody? What if you have to take care of people who don't have $1,000 to spend? And in the case of Apple Music, what if you have to take care of a community that is not going to simply throw away everything they own and switch over to all technology where you own where you're the engineers who design everything front to back? So it really is like it's not that they're dumb. It's not that they don't care. It's not that they're too focused on one core of their audience. It's that this is a skill they've never had a requirement to develop, and now they really have to start developing it if they really want to. If they want to become truly great with a capital G, they really have to start playing the game at expert level. And there's some areas in which they really have had it easy.
I wonder if this is also an issue of a larger issue with more than just Apple, but of all technology companies of maturity and complexity. You know, as we get farther and farther along, and we expect more and more. It just seems like they crap themselves.
It's hard. Changing is hard. Apple, most companies can't do it.
Legacy is Apple, the problem, right?
Yeah.
And Apple has traditionally gotten just ditched legacy. I mean, that's mm-hmm. one of the things that was a huge challenge for Microsoft, you know, is to keep all this stuff working for many, many years. And Apple would just go, yeah, we're not using that connector anymore. Yeah, we're not going to use this. Yeah. You know, like, yeah, we're just going to throw that out. And so Apple's traditional view has been just to throw it out and move everybody on to something else. And I think this is a more complicated problem for them.
Yeah.
Also, it's harder to satisfy an audience that doesn't already love you. Not exclusively, but a lot of the audience for Apple products have been people who have been drawn towards the company because they have a unique philosophy. They have a unique design aesthetic. They have a unique focus on the user that's not the same as the way that other companies focus on the user. It's a different thing when you have a device you're putting next to three or four other devices in front of a person who is relatively indifferent to the Apple logo. If they say that, look, well, all I'm looking for, again, we get back to cars. There are people who think that a certain make or model is the best car ever. I know that the electrics are not very good. I know that this is not going to last me 12 years. It's going to last me maybe 4 or 5 years. But boy, I like this sort of car, so I'm coming here because I love it. I'm buying this new electric car from Tesla because I love electric cars and I love what Tesla is doing. I don't care that the range right now is only 140 miles and it doesn't have 18 cup holders. It's different when someone walks on that lot saying, I've got $30,000 to spend on a car. I've got four kids and they've got 18 different week-long activities. And we also like to go camping. They're not going to love an Apple car because it's made by Apple. They're going to love a car that can actually suit all of their needs. And so sometimes when you have to start playing on that game, it's a lot harder to figure out how to make those people happy if they're not motivated to come to your logo to begin with.
All right. We've pinpointed the problem.
Music is hard.
Music is hard. I wonder, though. Legacy, I mean,
people care about it so much.
It doesn't. I wonder why you can't just throw it's not that Apple doesn't have talent or brains or money. Why can't couldn't you just sit down and solve it? I don't understand why you can't.
So it's easy when, like, I don't want to say it's easy. Like, when we have these discussions, they have exactly the same discussions inside, and then somebody will go, like, why don't we just stop porting iTunes to Windows? We'll give them a cloud interface, and then they'll go, but we just updated the iPod line with fresh new colors, and you can't sync that over a web browser. Oh, okay, so why don't we do this?
So it's a strategy tax?
Well, I had a friend who went to, like, he went to work for Apple, and he left the company a few years later, and he told me he arrived there on the first day and almost literally said, okay, I'm here. I'm going to fix all these things because I know what's wrong because I was on the internet.
Right.
And the guy took this box and he put it in front of him and he goes, this is the first time we tried to fix it. This is the second time we tried to fix it. This is the third time. And these are the repercussions of all those things, and they have to weigh those things. And then sometimes they're picking between the best of worst choices. Like, can't cut off all the Windows people, can't cut off all the iPods. What we can do now is move this piece so that when we get this piece over, it'll be easier to do that. And on the outside, we're like, this is molasses. And they're going, we're rolling as fast as we can, guys.
Right. Tough.
Yeah. I mean, it's a new problem when you've got, 400 million people that are.
Right. That's kind of what I mean. Is
$5 billion with this, whatever the revenue is flowing.
Yeah. It's easy when you're small and you can, Yeah.
Like, they're still on web objects for a lot of this. I mean, everybody there would love to be off it, but 5 billion in transactions going through those pipes.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, let's take a break. We got a lot more to talk about. Podcasting, for one. Apple, we need you to do a better job, say some podcasters. Not me, but apparently, according to the New York Times, some podcasters. We'll talk still a little more about Apple Music. Spotify says Apple Music's been good for us. Our growth has quickened since Apple Music launch. Apple Music now up to 13 million users, according to the quarterly earnings report. Spotify says we're growing too, which makes sense. It's raised awareness in general for the idea of this.
Well, they didn't say whether it was free or paid customers that were growing. As far as
they have 100 million users, 59 countries, but no profit. So,
well, the paid users are, I think, single digit million still.
Yeah. Interesting. Single digit, you think?
I think that someone said that. Someone said that it might be around or even slightly less than what Apple Music
is. So it's less than Apple Music. Wow.
Well, when you have free, it's an easy option.
Right. No, it says, no, I'm sorry. This article in Reuters says 30 million paying users on Spotify.
Oh, 30 million? Yeah. Okay, I didn't see that.
Yeah, 30. Apple 13. But then there's, Pandora's going to start a streaming service. There's Tidal and Deezer and Google Music and Amazon Music. It's a very competitive niche, and the music industry is really uncomfortable with it. And Spotify's raised $1 billion in debt, convertible debt. So it's got to be tough right now.
$30 million.
Apple, of course, has a 50% discount now for students. That's good, $4.99 a month. Family plan too. They're being very aggressive. And Apple's exclusive, as long as we're talking about Apple Music, I'll wrap up the Apple Music segment with Drake. Has been Betty, Betty good for Drake. 5 days, 1 million copies sold. It was only on Apple. It was an exclusive. All right, we're going to take a break. Come back with more. Renee Ritchie from iMore.com. From Pixel Core, it's Alex Lindsay. From the Chicago Sun-Times, Andy Anatko. And you're listening to Mac Break Weekly, our show today brought to you by Quicken Loans and Rocket Mortgage. Rocket is a good name because Rocket Mortgage is about speeding up the mortgage process. When you buy a house, last time I bought a house a couple of years ago, oh man, it was painful. Back and forth and lots of paperwork and faxes. And then it took so long that we had a vacation plan, and we're on vacation on a cruise ship trying to find a fax machine. It's crazy. Rocket Mortgage, I wish it had been around then. It is now, and if you're getting a mortgage, this is the way to do it. They bring the mortgage approval process into the 21st century entirely online. Fast, powerful, and entirely online. They take all the complicated, time-consuming parts out of a mortgage application, out of the equation. No, paperwork, no stacks of old files. You can share your bank statements, share your pay stubs with a click of a mouse. Everything's online now. Why not? Why print it out and fax it to them? That's nuts. You'll get approved in minutes for a custom mortgage solution tailored to your unique financial situation. And you can do all of it on your phone, too, or your tablet, too. Very easy from the convenience of your couch. And, if you're looking at houses, can I make a recommendation? This is something I learned. Get pre-approved at Rocket Mortgage.
That way, you're a much more attractive buyer. And nowadays, at least in this area, it's pretty competitive. If you're looking to refi, if you're looking to buy a home, Rocket Mortgage, go to quickenloans.com/MacBreak. quickenloans.com/MacBreak. Equal housing lender, licensed in all 50 states, NMLS, consumeraccess.org, number 3030. And we're very happy to have you. Welcome, Rocket Mortgage, to the Twit family. Rocket Mortgage by Quicken Loans. quickenloans.com/MacBreak. All right, moving on. I don't know if you saw. I was so excited. I saw the Sunday Times front page, below the fold, but front page. Podcast surge, but producers fear Apple isn't listening. And I went, oh, maybe we're lucky because we have a good relationship with Steve. And
I broke my head on my desk when I saw that article.
Oh, you're a podcaster. We're all podcasters. Yeah. So, according to this, I think you know. By the way, Marco had a great takedown at Marco.org, Marco Arment, who makes a podcast app and is a podcaster himself. And because he makes a podcast app, I think he's very connected to podcasters. First of all, he said, for some reason, when the New York media, especially the New York Times, talks about podcasting, what they really mean is NPR. Or the NPR spinoffs like Serial and, you know, Gimlet, and all these guys who came from All Things, This American Life and
traditional metric-based advertising companies.
Yeah. In the Times, and the article is written by John Herrmann, he says that Apple had a meetup, brought in the big podcasters. Were any of you there? Just out of curiosity.
No.
A podcaster to do that.
Was Steve Austin there? That's what I want to know.
Yeah. Yeah. I think this probably is a misunderstanding, because Apple talks to podcasters all the time, and we've been there, and... But they say that the big podcasters that Apple brought in, interviews with over 24 podcasters and people inside Apple reveal a variety of complaints. The podcasters say they are relegated to wooing a single Apple employee for the best promotion. That is true. Not a problem, but that is true. It's Steve that does it all, right? We love Steve.
I mean, like, that's not so, like, I hate when they mention Apple employees because they never do it in context. That's not unique to podcasts. Apple, as part of Eddie Q's organization, although the App Store ones have moved to Phil Schiller, they have editors, and those they've always had them. It's for movies, it's for music, it's for podcasts, it's for apps, it's for iBooks. They're human curators whose job it is to sift through all this stuff and sort of try to build themes.
And it's different in every country. So Steve Wilson and James Bogg, his boss, are in the U.S., but every country has its own. It's an editorial team. It's the same for the App Store.
And they have to be more. It's just one guy got transferred, and I don't believe they've replaced him. I mean, like, the whole story lacks. If you know Apple and you read this story, you just want to, again, break your desk with your head.
But Marco makes a point, and I think...
Yeah, exactly.
Marco really makes an excellent point. Apple's actual role in podcasting, be careful what you wish for, is we don't want Apple to turn iTunes and the podcast apps into the App Store. He says, trust me. You don't want that. Podcasts are like blogs. It's an open standard. There are many different podcast platforms. I don't think any of us want Apple to become a gatekeeper, to do metrics, to pry into our listeners' lives and personal information. I don't think Apple wants to do that, to get analytics, to do monetization. Marco says, completely decentralized, free, fair, open, and uncontrollable by any single entity, and that's the way it is. We don't want to turn it into what the web has turned into, which is an ad tech ridden cesspool of advertising.
Yeah. When I read that article, when I read about complaints that there's just one guy that we have to deal with, I was reading, we don't have the ability to leverage our really expensive marketing and publicity department to heavily lobby and or pay to influence somebody to give us a better placement above other people. It's kind of good that there is sort of a secret process by which certain shows get promoted and certain shows don't. And isn't it better to know that just some 12-year-old kid who started a podcast that's just good, according to some certain human beings, gets to be right up there front and center to find a new audience. And the brand new Honey Nut Cheerios Bee podcast is is getting 18 listeners and no promotion, just despite how much money General Mills is putting into the promotion of it.
Like Laura just got a I mean, Laura started what, a year ago, and just one guy, a 30-minute show, and it just got picked up as a TV deal, and it got heavily. It was one of the new podcasts of the year on iTunes, and he's competing with the biggest producers. I mean, I can understand, because I used to work in analytics, why a lot of companies want, they've been sort of, what's the right word, fattened up on this market of, we'll give you exact numbers and you'll know who played and how many people this, and then they can game those systems. They can bid and they can create these incredibly complex algorithms to do, but that is usually good for giant aggregators. That is seldom good for people, and you sort of have to figure out what you want out of this. And
I think it goes back into the same complaint that we see with the App Store. You know, people were like, "Well, but they didn't give us everything. They didn't give us everything we asked for." You know,
I don't want them to give us anything.
No,
I mean, that's
the whole thing is they mostly stay out.
It's a directory.
Of all the things that Apple does, this is the thing that they stay out of. You know,
it's a directory.
They do not get into it. They're not taking it away from I don't want them to take 30%. I don't want to have rules about what kind of advertisers I can run. I don't want to have all of the things that would come with more help.
Yeah, Marco says that. Be careful what you wish for.
Yeah, I don't want to have to not use naughty words if I choose to use naughty words. Right. I don't want to have to not talk about topics that are gross. Right.
I think this is part of why Apple stayed away from it, to allow people to do whatever they're going to do with it, and you know, within a very wide set of rules, just stay out. You know, has just basically stayed out of the way of the podcasters. And I think that they've created a great platform that people are making money at. Maybe not everyone maybe it's not as easy as everyone would like it, but you know, there is a way to climb up there.
Well, so there's, sounds like in this article, there's two things that the, whoever these people were that met with Apple wanted. One was metrics. Don't want that. Apple's not the company to provide metrics. And that's just not the way or analytics about our audiences. And Apple could, I guess, do that because a lot of people play back podcasts through iTunes. But it's no longer the vast majority.
They wouldn't anyway, because the podcast itself collects no data, so they would have to link it with device data that they know about you, which is the last thing that
Apple's
would ever want to
do. That.
They've gone to great measures to decouple those kinds of
things. And Apple, I just want to tell you, we don't want you to do that either. We're not asking you to do that. And then maybe have some sort of subscription service for podcasts. No, there's plenty of good ways to do that. You don't need to do that with Apple. And finally, I guess what they're saying is it should be easier for us to promote ourselves to Apple. And I think it's fine to have Steve decide what he likes and promote it. And that's fine. I don't, you know, the one thing I think has always bugged me is the top podcast lists, because I think people think that means the most subscribed to podcasts, and it's not, never has been. It's the most subscribed to in iTunes this week list. It's like a Billboard chart, and so it doesn't count total listens by any means.
But I think in some ways it measures a certain trend.
Ballistics.
Of people going towards something. Ballistics. Because otherwise it would be right now. It'd be This American Life would be number one all the time.
Well, it is all the time, like, because they do a...
They keep on adding.
Yeah. Because they play a trick, actually, to get on number one on there. We don't, you know, I'm sure they have a lot of listeners. But when we release a new podcast, it often goes to number one, then it slowly goes back down. Does that mean people are unsubscribing? No. It means there are the ballistics are different. There are fewer new subscriptions. In fact, the largest older podcasts will not be on those lists, because we don't get as many new subscribers because everybody subscribes. Anyway, I don't want to sound whiny on this. I'm not. I'm very happy with how it works. And just remember, Apple's not the only player. There's Stitcher. And there's a guy at Stitcher you call. there's a lot of these.
The super important thing is that the Apple, whatever system Apple has created, Apple has not created a system where you cannot have a successful and sustaining podcast if you are not being helped by Apple with good placement and good positioning. And that means that whatever system they've got is working really great.
Yeah. It's
there's a concept, you know, of you know, using Twitter, using Facebook, building a web page.
Yeah, you have to promote yourself.
The old fashioned marketing.
Way. Yes.
That, you know, that they don't have to hand it to you. You know, there's a lot of tools out there to engage your audience.
Love this kid. We're trying to get him on the new Screensavers. 15 years old. He's building the main computer museum. He's 15. He has 200 vintage Apple computers. It's a Mac museum. And it's beautifully done. I mean, look, I don't know. This is gorgeous.
And it's not Stephen Hackett. That's important to realize. This is a different person than Stephen Hackett.
It's Alex Jason, and this is his basement. The nicest looking basement I've ever seen. He's got all the different colored iMacs, including that weird hippie iMac with the flowers on it.
Flower power.
What is this big server over here? Is that an X-Serve?
No, I don't know.
No, it's a
printer.
It's from the pre-Steve days when they were making I forget the name of it, but they were basically taking like Mac LCs and stacking them and basically putting it in any box that could actually serve them.
Dalmatian iMac is still.
I love. Is that what they call it? The Dalmatian iMac. That's the spotted one. really cool. He started as a 10-year-old. And in 2010, he traded a mini bike and an electric snowblower for an iMac G5. And I guess he just got the bug. 200 Apple machines. He and his father, Bill, are now planning to display the collection known as Alex's Apple Orchard in one of those old Carnegie libraries in Fairfield, Maine.
Great.
Yeah, it's good. Those are great old buildings. It'll be called the Maine Technology Museum. He has an Apple I from 1976 that still works with the original chips.
I'm wondering how he got a hold of that. I mean, it's like an expensive piece of machine.
I'm thinking,
well, because it's amazing. Like there are people who have these old things and they don't really love them anymore, but they don't want to sell it to some millionaire idiot who's going to think it is a cool curio and Instagram it and then forget about it. But if you find that one person who will absolutely love it, particularly if it's a 12-year-old kid,
right.
That's the person that you send it to. It's like I went through exactly the same thing when I was a kid, where I was also collecting old computers, and a friend of a friend through a stranger would find out there's this kid in Boston who is really, really interested in like IMSI gear. And again, there's this thing that was important to them about 15 years ago, but not so much now. And the idea that, well, here's someone who's actually going to really use it and appreciate it for what it is, the same way that I appreciated it. I'd be more than willing to give it to this person if this person can con his father into driving 100 miles to come pick it up, because no way in hell am I going to ship an IMSI 8080
if this person has a nonprofit status and can handle a write-off.
I think that was long before that. But the Apple One is hell of a score, because when I was his age or a little younger than that, I saw an ad in the back of Byte magazine for a working Apple One for $1,200.
But
I'm saying a 12-year-old kid cannot get his hands on $1,200. Or an old computer, and no one was collecting old computers back then. So that was when it really was, do you have a truck and can you carry this junk out so we don't have to throw it away? That's what it was like. All the stuff that I've got in storage is mostly, I do have some quote valuable unquote stuff, but that was because I've been going to the MIT flea market for like 15 or 20 years. And back when I saw Macintosh 128s go from $150 to $100 to $50, I have 30 of these for $5. Just take as many as you want. Well, and you can, if you want more, I've got them in storage.
According to the article, his first breakthrough was buying a collection of 50 Apple computers, a 26 foot long U-Haul for $2,000 he'd saved from mowing lawns. So exactly. Although that Apple One, a similar Apple One sold at auction last year for $900,000.
Yeah.
So this is probably a million dollar collection at this point. He buys from collectors from eBay. It's really neat.
His collection of one of a kinds, like a clear plastic cased iMacs and stuff like that, and clear plastic Newtons. That's the stuff that's really cool.
Yeah, he's got leases.
Cool. I'm worrying though that when people find out that his Apple One is worth that much money.
Oof.
I wonder where he's got it stored and if he's now scared of where he's got it.
Yeah. Have you, I mean, that's fairly near to you. Have you gone to visit
Lewiston, Maine?
I think you need to make a trip.
That's a New Englander will look at that and say, wow, the kid sold a mini bike and a snowblower in Maine. In Maine, that's like everything that you need. The mini bike because there's nothing but like forest and dirt trails to have fun with, and the snowblower is how you make $2,000 to spend on a collection of computers. That's a very, very special fan to sell those things. It's sort of like saying we were dependent on one well for water, and I sold my collection of buckets. And all of our cookware. It's like, yeah, those are key things for Maine.
Incidentally, Alex himself does not use an Apple computer. He has a home-built PC. He just collects them. It reminds me of Alex Gumpel over here, who is a diehard Windows user, our Flowmaster, one of our engineering team, and he collects old Mac stuff, and he's got old Mac documents. It was great because he had a shrink-wrapped copy of Hypercar that we got Bill Atkinson to sign for him. So that's kind of cool. So I think there are a lot of these around. We're going to go visit the Obi-Wan. What is it called? The Obi-Wan Museum, which is up the road a piece. You must know about that.
I've heard about that.
I don't know anything about that.
Yeah, it's a Star Wars memorabilia collection.
So, it's a collection of just like every single piece of Star Wars merchandise ever, including prototypes of stuff that never got sold.
Yeah.
It's not open to the public except for by appointment, and he does consulting, and I've seen
Rancho Obi-Wan. We're going to, the new screensavers. I think it's this week. We're going to do a story on it. They asked me if I wanted to go, and I said, you know, you really should send one of our team that is like crazy about this stuff. So I think Father Robert's going to go. I mean, I would go, but I think it'd be better to send somebody who's just like, wow, this is the best thing I've ever seen.
It's a little bit strange, though. I would totally have to like wear astronaut diapers if I ever got to tour the Lucasfilm.
That's
archives.
Who I want to send.
But it's I'm really impressed by Rancho Obi-Wan. But when I see all the videos of it, it's like, okay, here's just racks and racks and racks of puzzles and games and toys. None of it was involved with the actual movie. They were just commercial stuff. And I don't know. It's like I do own a set of original action figures because I think they're kind of cool. But I'm not sure how much fun I would have to say, oh, well, here are the 18 different kinds of Millennium Falcon toys that they made.
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I guess that's the point, is that collectors are obsessive, and it's obsessive about their particular, you know, thing, right?
It's very, very personal. I have my own collections, and some of them are, I almost have to really explain why I collect these things, because it just seems weird if you see this rack of like little teacups and little like sauce.
You collect sauce teacups?
Not teacups. I used to, I haven't done it in a while because it involved theft. But
are there hotel teacups or something like that?
Well, I used to have this thing where like every time I would go on a trip, I would try to come home with like a little canakin or a little thing that you put like a side order or whatever, would have a little cup of sauce you might drizzle on it.
Yeah.
And so and started with like my first trip to San Francisco, where I had a wonderful dinner with like 12 friends. It was such a good dinner that I just decided to take a little rice cup with me, just as a memento of this wonderful dinner.
Mementos, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then I decided I was doing it like all the time. Not like, you know, a heist sort of thing. And sometimes I shifted it from actually stealing this piece of tableware to I need to con the server into letting me take it, which added an extra level of challenge and authenticity. And then there came a time where, again, so I've got these boxes and boxes of things, each with little labels on them of here's where I had dinner here, and here's from this my trip to London on this time, and then I realized that I'm spending a lot of time trying to get servers to let me
Kleptomaniacs Anonymous, the Shulman Center. We're going to make an appointment for you, and we'll have you there in a moment. I
stopped about 10 years ago.
That was Jason's editorial comment on.
we all have those sort of things where it's hard to explain. Comic collectors are the same way. When I used to collect original comic art and artist sketches, I would spend a lot of time waiting in line to get a sketch from a certain artist, and you swap portfolios. You get to see, oh, you collect nothing but sketches of Mary Marvel. Isn't that interesting? Or you collect nothing but sketches of characters with your who are holding your pet your pet parrot. And it's like, again, it's hard to explain to an outsider why this is such a cool collection to you, but putting things together in a way that makes sense to you is in itself an act of creation.
Well, I'm just looking at Renee's shot. I'm thinking, oh, you don't collect anything in particular, Renee. Nothing.
No, zero. Silch. Yeah. This will not be donated to a museum when I pass away, when it all falls on me and takes my life.
What is that? Rock'em Sock'em Robots on your?
Oh, it's an homage to Civil War.
Oh, it's Captain America and Iron Man fighting it out.
Yeah.
Did you see the movie?
I did.
Good?
I really liked it, but I'm a huge fan of what the Russo brothers in particular have done with the huge canvas that is the Marvel Universe.
You know what I saw last night, because it finally came out for rental, is Deadpool.
Yeah.
That is so inappropriate, but it was really good.
It was really funny.
It's like the most inappropriate movie I've ever seen.
It is exactly what worked about that movie is that they basically took the comic book and made it. And people think, people want Raji. Yeah. No. That is just Deadpool put on a movie screen.
Yep. Yeah, that's what my comic book loving nephew says. Mario says, "Oh no, it's just exactly what was in the comic." And I guess this guy that they got, who everybody knows except I don't, whatever his name is, he's very appropriate casting for the guy.
Yeah, it's good. Now I'm so eager for a Deadpool Harley Quinn team up movie. Ooh, I can't even tell you.
I like
you.
That.
That's good. That's going to be worth $12 of anybody's money.
The tech angle in Deadpool for me was, I thought that it was interesting because it reminded me very much of the kind of humor I see in these YouTube videos where guys are wisecracking while they're playing video games. And maybe that came from the comics and got to YouTube. But I feel like this is a movie for the YouTube generation. For the first one I've really seen that I think would appeal to the kids, who they don't watch TV now. I watch my 13-year-old. He doesn't watch TV. He watches these YouTube videos, and he's chortling away as, you know, these guys are kind of swearing. And it's not just PewDiePie. There's a whole bunch of these making fun of the game and laughing. And it's very much that same style. Yeah, see that? Feel the love, Valentine's Day, Deadpool. It is incredibly violent. It's totally sexual. Ryan Reynolds, that's the guy. Anyway, I don't know how I got into that.
Where do you go from there? I don't want to devolve the conversation, but again, it's one of those things where, thanks to like the continual escalation of entertainment, it's getting faster paced and more irreverent. Is it just you wonder where it can keep going? Yeah. There's very little shock value left.
This is going to be Ryan Reynolds' breakout though, because he is Deadpool. I mean,
it'll make us forget Green Lantern.
Thank God. And what is it, Two Men and a Girl or whatever?
Yeah.
Apple supplier Foxconn is about to open a giant iPhone manufacturing plant, $10 billion, 1,200-acre iPhone manufacturing plant in India. Foxconn is apparently aiming, according to a 9 to 5 Mac, to open 10 to 12 manufacturing facilities in India by 2020. Makes sense because the Indian government looks askance at companies that don't make products in India. And it's been hard, for instance, for Apple to get a retail store in there. It's hard for them to sell iPhones in India. But I think if you open a $10 billion plant to make iPhones.
Well, it happened in Brazil, right? I mean, those are those famous BRIC countries, the emerging markets, Brazil, Russia, India, and China. And China, the factories were already there. Russia is a very different market. Brazil has huge import taxes, so Foxconn had to start expanding into there.
Right.
And India has very, very similar rules. And they're trying to protect their markets and grow their economy. And so Foxconn is, if you can't bring them to you, you go to them.
And we reported last week that Apple was turned down on the to sell used iPhones at a low cost in India, and they've been trying to open retail stores. Go ahead. I'm sorry, Alex.
No, and I think that usually what this is referred to is offset agreements. So, if we're gonna allow things to be bought here, then we expect you to build a certain percentage of those there. This is very, very common in the defense industry to build parts of F-16s or something in South Africa for them to buy them. And so these offset agreements are pushed more heavily in the emerging world typically because obviously they have a lot of people to employ. It'll be interesting to see whether Foxconn, this new factory is a next generation factory. We've heard a lot about Foxconn working on automation and so on and so forth. So, this may be an opportunity for them to experiment with, what some of those manufacturing processes may look like. Yeah. It'll still employ a lot of people. I mean, it's going to employ a lot of people, but that's part of the use of it. So they're not going to go crazy, but I bet you it'll be a lot more modern than what they're even doing in China.
It's the number two market after China, right? and not being able to get in there. I mean, it's very big for new iPhones, but not being able to get in there with used iPhones in retail slows it down. They'd love to get that market.
And I'm sure that India understands that they have leverage, and this is the time to use that. If you're, you know, they definitely have an they have a lot of people that are highly trained in India, you know, and so this is something that they definitely are going to use that leverage. And I think it's in some ways appropriate to make sure that folks are doing that. There's not a cost benefit that would have you not do it in India, other than not building the factory, because the wages will be similar to. What they're already paying in China, so it's a much easier thing to calculate.
Market is so different; it's not as big as China, and also the middle class is not as quick as percentage, I believe, as China. So the market for new iPhones is not what you know what it is in China, even. The second hand. Yeah, well, not yet, but arguably, you know, again, China's bigger and their middle class is growing faster. So eventually, it'll get there. But short term for Apple, those used devices and getting those into stores is really important.
I don't know what's going on. The TriCaster's going crazy.
Alexander Hamilton.
Anti Anatko.
I felt like if the camera's going to be on me while we're saying that, you should at least look through myself.
You did. You were very thoughtful looking.
Yes, exactly.
It was lagging there.
He's pushing the button and nothing's happening. Let's take a break. Do you want to reboot the TriCaster?
No, I don't think it's that bad.
Okay.
Because it takes so long.
It's scattering. It's been weird. I think we need to get a new hard drive in there or something. It's been a little sluggish of late. We've been rebooting it a lot. You know how these things are. These computers, they get old. But when you get an old device, what do? You sell it on Gazelle. You don't throw it in the drawer. That's like throwing $100 bills in the drawer.
What a pro. What a pro. That is decades of experience behind the microphone, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Gazelle's the place to sell your used devices, get cash for them, and you can get a good price too. But you don't have to guess, because you go to Gazelle right now and you'll get a quote on an old iPhone and iPads, tablets from Samsung and Apple and even Microsoft and Google, even computers and displays. Gazelle buys them, pays top dollar. But the nice thing is that quote is guaranteed for 30 days. You lock them in the minute you go there. It's a good idea, because even 30 days, you're going to see the price dropping on almost all these devices. They just aren't getting more valuable. So if you think, even think you might want to get rid of your phone and get a new one, or your tablet and get a new one, maybe you got a broken iPhone or iPad, they buy those too. Go to gazelle.com right now and get a quote. That's locked in for 30 days. You have 30 days to decide. They pay the postage. They will wipe your data if you can't or forget to. And then they'll send you cash, well, a check or PayPal credit if you want it faster, or get those Amazon gift cards, and they bump those up by 5%. It's a good deal. And look at that. If you're going to go there, you'll not only get paid, but you might want to look at the store where they sell used devices, because you can get a $20 credit towards that used device by selling your old device on Gazelle. So this is a great opportunity to sell and buy. At gazelle.com. They take the best stuff, the creme de la creme, slightly used, gently used iPhones and iPads, even the Samsung Galaxy phones. They inspect them, 30-point inspection, guaranteeing them for 30 days. They have a 30-day return policy. They work on all the major carriers, but they are sold without a carrier contract, so that's nice. They even have financing now by a firm at gazelle.com you can do at checkout. You can get instantly approved for 3, 6, or 12 months. Easy monthly payments. Just select financing with a firm as you check out. They also have a 12-month warranty for cell phones and iPads you buy from Gazelle, powered by Assurance Solutions. And it's a good warranty. It covers water damage, cracked screens, hardware defects, and more. G-A-Z-E-L-L-E, gazelle.com. To buy or to sell or both. You'll even get more money if you do both at Gazelle. We thank him so much for supporting MacBreak Weekly and helping to fund. Who was I talking to the other day? He sent a bunch of stuff to Gazelle, $1,200 worth of stuff to the Gazelle.
Awesome.
Yeah. I remember talking to one of our hosts who paid her rent 1 month from the stuff she sent to Gazelle. It's great.
And she wound up with more space in the place that she was now renting.
There you go. I don't know if I want to credit Tim Beharin with anything, because he's an analyst. He's been around for ages and ages. Not always exactly right, but he has an article in Time Magazine. The real reason Apple made the Apple Watch, and it's credible. It's on the first anniversary of the Apple Watch. The estimate of sales is 13 to 15 million, $2 to $3 billion in revenue. So it's been a good year, but Tim's saying that it's because of Steve's illness. Jobs spent a lot of time, obviously, in the healthcare system. 7 years from the time he was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer in 2004 to his death in 2011. And he thought that the healthcare system could be improved. We've pointed to Tim Cook a lot for all of the stuff Apple's doing in healthcare, but really it's, according to Beharin, and I think he's probably accurate, it started with Steve Jobs. And that the Apple Watch really started as a health device as much as anything else. I guess that makes sense. It's
I agree.
Yeah,
that jives with stuff that I was hearing during the development of the Apple Watch. That's why I was actually thinking that Apple was working more on something like a really really good fitness band as opposed to a watch platform.
Where do we go with Apple Watch now? 1 year in.
Yeah, again, it's to me it's just one of those. It doesn't have a point of view. It's a very, all it has to do is be a really cool watch, and it's a really cool watch. And I'm not criticizing it. I'm just saying that I just don't think it has a point of view, and that's it'll become something much bigger and better once Apple decides what its purpose is, as opposed to here is one of those. See, other people made one of these, and we've made one of these as well.
Yep.
Enjoy.
Well, and it's one of those that syncs well with your phone, which there's a lot of people that.
That's enough, right?
Yeah, no, it really is. I mean, when you look at the whether it's Apple Music or the Apple Maps or the watch, you know, they really can. They have a built-in market that's large enough that they can simply just do something that works well with what they already have. I mean, that's the advantage of having an ecosystem. You know, there's a lot of people that just don't want to deal with the cross-pollination of between devices where they don't feel like they're going to get the best one. So if you decide you want a smartwatch, which you know, I've spent a lot of money on watches. But once you start using a smartwatch and you have your updates and your phone calls and you see what's going on, it'd be very hard for me to go back to a regular watch. And so then you're just making a decision about, you know, which watch is going to be, you know, what phone do I have and what's compatible and how does that work? Now, right. At some point, I think that these watches become more self-sufficient. But even then, you're really dealing with managing, you know, how you want to interact with your ecosystem.
Yeah, and there's going to be, I mean, like right now we're dealing with a very small subset of things. But in the future, a lot of technology we're going to be tied to, like identity, remote control, access to all the stuff around us. And now Apple has a platform that they can engage with that. I mean, before the show, I turned my Apple Watch and I said, you know, to the virtual assistant, turn on the studio lights. And lo, there were studio lights turned on. And I used them last time I was staying at Aloft Hotel to get into my room because they have this really fancy technology where if they detect metal distortion near the lock, it looks for a Bluetooth signal because then it can judge proximity and it unlocks your door for you. That gives you both convenience and security. And that kind of stuff, I mean, right now it's very fringe, but you know, you go from fringe to widely adopted in the blink of an eye. And Apple uncharacteristically entered this in the early adopters market. Usually they wait a decade and do it when it becomes sort of a mainstream technology. So it'll be interesting to see how they navigate that. But I think absolutely getting this technology onto your wrist and looking at the health benefits, the notification benefits, the identity benefits are going to be huge for them because the phone was sort of one big step that way. And the next logical step, even if it's nowhere near as big as the phone business, is having that on your wrist or at least somewhere that's on you all the time.
Yeah, but we're still in the phase, I think, where it's sort of like the way that all phones were, where it was hard for any one company to distinguish themselves because they were, when you get down to it, they were offering here, it will place and receive phone calls, it will send and receive text messages, it will also send and receive multimedia messages, so it has a camera, so you can send a snapshot and receive one. But there was no maker was having a really good time explaining to people that ours is doing something that's materially different from anything the rest of the makers are doing. And in the field of wearables right now, smartwatches, it really is fitness tracking, notifications, actionable notifications from your phone onto your wrist, and being able to do simple controls and simple tap sort of commands. And really, I don't think that the Apple Watch has really distinguished itself over anything else like that. I know a lot of people like Renee and like Alex who feel as though who would definitely go back to their house if they realized they left their Apple Watch at home. If in the unlikely event they would even not take their Apple Watch with them. But I know in terms of people that I know who had Apple Watches a year ago today or during the summer, I know equally as many, if not more, that it's in the rotation somewhere, but they can do without it because it was, again, it was just, for them, it was just one of those.
Speaking of ecosystems, rumor has it, according to 9 to 5 Mac and Jordan Kahn, that Apple's going to have a HomeKit app, standalone HomeKit app, in iOS 10. Is it too little, too late?
They've had one internally for a while, you know, because they need one just to do a bunch of internal processes. They were kind of hoping that you wouldn't need it, that it'd be simpler without it. But I think I use the Home app. It's a $10 app that a developer, a third-party developer made, and it just makes it much easier to find and coordinate everything. And I think that's sort of like the Health app. That's something that would have behooved Apple to have last year, if not the year before.
Right.
Yeah. So sometimes you really have to focus on how do people interact with something and how do people expect to work with something. And Siri is wonderful, but there is a level at which people are expecting to have a button to push. And there's a level at which a lot of people don't know what HomeKit can do unless you have a menu in front of them, unless you see a list of devices. Also, a lot of these devices aren't terribly reliable. Mine, sometimes they will appear and disappear off the net depending on what's going on. And so I find myself looking about as foolish as I would have 15 years ago, saying, "Hey, Shlomo, turn on the office lights. Shlomo, turn on the office lights. Hey, Shlomo, office lights on, red." And
hey, Shlomo.
Shlomo, I'm talking to you.
And there is sensitivity, though, because, I mean, a lot of vendors don't want Apple to sort of take over their apps for them. They wanted people to still go to their apps and not just go to some universal home app where they could do everything and never see whatever. I mean, they always put a bunch of junk in their app that maybe you don't want, but they really want in there. So a lot of these things involve negotiations, and Apple sort of saying, look, that doesn't work. We tried to appease you, and we're going to do it this way now.
On top of stuff like that, a lot of these devices, the makers are a lot more clever about their own devices than Apple will ever be. For instance, the Amazon Echo just added integration with Google Calendar. And it really is, that's one piece of junk mail that I have flagged in my mail server that, no, I know this is mass mailing.
Yeah,
but
I want to read that every time.
Put this at the top of my inbox. Every time they say, here's new features we've added to your Amazon Echo. And now the fact that I can just simply bark out, please add this to my schedule, or what time is my next thing? Is that 4 o'clock or five o'clock?
Pretty awesome.
Without having done anything, that it simply starts up.
Yeah.
It would be problematic if I had to wait for Apple to support that through Siri or for Apple to support that through another app. It's just like the watch. This is such a new technology, and it's so in flux at this point. This is a lump of clay that we're all still smacking at with our hands, and we don't know what the shape of it is yet. And in 5 years, it'll be easier to do the sort of thing that is utopian in scope. For now, it's maybe a good idea to have separate apps on the phone and separate apps, web clients, so that we can see what's out there on our network and make sure we know what each one can do today.
It's just, I feel like I keep waiting for the home automation thing to take off.
I mean, it's so new and it has so many problems. Like, people were complaining about Apple was being overly worried about security.
Yeah.
But then we saw all the stories about how easy it was to attack people's NAS networks with all these unprotected Internet of Things devices on them. So it did take a while because people had to upgrade infrastructure, their routers, and they had to upgrade the hubs that controlled all these things. And now we're getting to a point where it's mature and it's good technology and it's functional and it is secure, so that by putting in those lights, you're not just giving everyone unfettered access to your house and you don't have to worry about someone remotely unlocking your doors. And these were all legitimate concerns before. And again, Apple entered that market really early. There wasn't a decade of home automation stuff for them to look at and see, oh, those are the problems we're going to solve for X, Y, and Z. So they're figuring it out along with all of us. But I think we will see over the next year, the next 2 or 3 years especially, this kind of stuff just ramp up as people get over that initial hump. The first deployments are really, really, really hard, especially hard to get right. And once those happen, people can start replicating those things. And it goes get more exciting as you can start linking more and more things together more easily. I don't want to say we need, a visual building block system, hypercards for home automation, but something like that will come out that makes it super accessible for everyone to sort of control every aspect of their home.
Well, and I think that a lot of us are excited about it. I mean, I'm extremely excited about home automation, office automation, all those things that kind of, because you just feel like there's just this huge mess of things, and you know that you shouldn't have to use your key and everything else. But I do think that caution is warranted in this area. It only takes one bad robbery because someone was able to hack through your Hue light, you know, to, right. you know, someone figured out some back door that I go through this light and then I got to open the door and then bad things happen. And it only takes one of those before it sets you back by, you know, a decade. So I think that that's what I think everyone's afraid of.
It's awfully nice that you can do this incrementally, though. Like Renee says, I mean, it's there's going to be a lot of fear about if someone had to spend $1,000 to upgrade their entire house for automation. But I mean, I most of my light bulbs now are LED, and it's not because I spend $500 to swap out all of my compact fluorescents. It's because every now and then when I needed a new light bulb, I would replace that bulb with LED, then that bulb with LED, and then suddenly they're all there. I think that we're going to get to a point where adding a Wi-Fi chip is going to make a light LED light bulb just a little bit more expensive. And so people will say, well, if it's only cost $3 more to have this Wi-Fi enabled, and it says here in the box it'll work with both Google Now and Siri, why don't I got that. It's such a hassle to have to turn off that light every time I come into the house. I'll replace this one bulb with it, and then they'll replace another bulb with it. And then 5 years later, your Wi-Fi, you've got all these smart bulbs in your house. You happen to have upgraded your Wi-Fi router so that now it works with all that sort of stuff. And now all your phones support it as well. And that's when people are willing to spend the $80 for that extra magic box that will make thermostats work and stuff like that.
Speaking of Shlomo, the creators of Shlomo have created a new application.
Herschel.
Herschel. Yeah. We can say Viv until it comes out. Dag Kitlaus, who created Siri and sold it to Apple, gosh, like 5 years ago. And Apple's really not improved Siri much. In fact, in some respects, it's dumbed Siri down from its original standalone app. Have released or created a new app called Viv. You want to see a little of Viv at work, and then I want to know if you think this is revolutionary. Viv understands longer compound sentences and. And I think this is most important. It's an open platform, so it can do more because developers can make it integrate with their apps more easily. Here's Dag.
I need a ride for six people from my office to Madison Square Garden.
He needs a ride for six people from his office to Madison Square Garden. Viv, he's doing it on his phone.
All right, so our friends from Uber are going to help us out here.
Viv does, by the way, not talk. At least didn't talk in this demo, as far as I can tell.
When they do actually have voice output, I'm going to insist that they pay Adrian Edmondson a lot of money to do his Viv character from The Young Ones.
Okay.
All right, we're going to get you a kid right now. Hey, look,
call me Stig.
Right in the name.
Viv is working with 1-800-Flowers and Weather Underground, in this case with Uber. And it delivered Uber map and pricing and everything. And it's now actually calling the Uber app and finding
right,
a ride. And tells him.
Right. Well, I'm sorry, Robert. I'm going to have to cancel this ride today, but hopefully we get a chance in the future.
Poor Robert.
We're going to cancel.
This is TechCrunch disrupting New York City.
Yeah. Well, and I was surprised. I guess I had the impression that they had bought the company that made Siri rather than bought the technology, but I guess Apple didn't have the money to buy.
No, everyone went to Apple for a while, and then Dag and some Siri engineers left to go make
Vive. Once they vested, they said, thank you very much. Goodbye. We're going to do something. Apparently their non-competes didn't last long enough to.
Well, they're in California. Business.
Right. Well, but I think probably you can do it not as a hiring thing, which is illegal, but as part of your contract, you could say, you know, we'll buy it, but you got to promise not to make a competing technology.
Or also sometimes your stocks vest at a certain point and you wait around
long enough for those stocks.
Yeah.
Yeah. So usually it's 3 years, you know, you'll get vested in 3 years and you can't make a similar product for some time. It's been 5 years. I think it's reasonable to think that time frame ran out. Now, I want to point out, and I showed this yesterday on iOS Today, there already is an app called Hound from the SoundHound folks. It does a lot of this stuff. But both of these are better than Siri and Google Now and Cortana and Echo.
It depends on the problem set you're trying to solve. Like in some ways, Amazon Echo blows Siri out of the water when you're talking about how it handles queries essentially by Americans. But then you look at Apple TV now, and it's handling multilingual. So you can be in France and you can say, montre-moi le Beverly Hills cop, and it not only will find that for you, but it'll recognize that you spoke French in the beginning, then switch to English for the title, which is an incredibly, when you stop and think about
that's
how it has
good.
To solve that
yeah,
problem.
Yeah.
And Google's doing similar things with now. They're all sort of focusing on different areas of this technology, and they're falling behind in some, getting ahead in others. But I think all of them are doing a really good job in the areas that they're putting a lot of attention into. And it's just, it's frustrating because you think all of them should be good in everything right away. But you know, there is a steady improvement in all of those voice assistants over time.
Yeah.
And we're really getting to a point, I mean, I think that I see this all the time, where you're really running out of programmers. I mean, there are a certain number of people that know how to do this, and it's not you're pumping the knowledge. There's a certain number of people that know how to do this, and all of them have been hired, you know, and so you are not, you know, I mean, they all are. I mean, you know, like if you have a specialty, you know, you're not looking for work, you're deciding where you want to work at this point, especially in these kinds of AI areas. So I think that a lot of them have, you know, they all have their groups of people. It's much like automation with cars, the HomeKit, the Internet of Things, and, the AI stuff is just in incredible demand. And so, you can hire programmers, but it doesn't mean that you can hire programmers that really understand, you know, how this works.
Yeah, and Siri just added Hebrew and other languages as well, and they've had Mandarin support, and I believe Cantonese support for a while too. And adding each one of those things means solving for all the intricacies of those languages as well. And Google is doing similar things, which requires Herculean amounts of effort at the same time.
It does seem slow work. I do feel like, though, that having an API and opening yourselves up to other apps. So if you install Viv on an iPhone and then install, say, the Uber app, it will add capabilities to Viv. I think that's a very good way to do that. And the fact that Echo supports is so easy to add skills to. It has one problem, which is that you, as Andy said, you have to kind of keep an eye on what new skills there are and remember to use them. But it really is an open platform. I like the idea of an open platform, and that's one thing Siri and Google now are not.
Well, they've been flirting with an API for several years. I mean, you keep hearing it floated internally, and then for one reason or another, it doesn't get shipped. And I think one of the things here, and you can call it a problem if you want, is that Apple has this culture of APIs that they want them to be rock solid, and they want to make sure that you can depend on them for years once they roll them out. It's not like, you know, some companies will just put out an API and then iterate on it really quickly, and the developers would be like, oh, I can no longer do this, I've got to change, this is terrible. But they get it deployed and they get it moving really quickly. Where Apple, it was sort of things like, add this to my calendar, okay, but you know, you've got Fantastical and you've got our calendar and you've got calendar 5, and now we have a whole bunch of collisions, and how do we elegantly handle that? And that apparently has been, at least early on, was a large part of the discussion around this.
I wonder, though, I think Apple might also be a little politically conflicted about APIs. Remember, they were going to open up FaceTime, never did. I don't think ever will.
They got sued into oblivion, though. I mean, that was an exception where Steve Jobs got on stage, said, we're going to make FaceTime open. Every engineer in the audience goes, we are? We never heard this. Is that really true? And then they started working on it, and they immediately got sued by, I forget, Vitrex.
Oh, okay.
And they had to completely
re-architect. So they were prevented from that.
Yeah, I mean, that there's no FaceTime. If you look at FaceTime carefully, it has had a glacial evolution. There's no FaceTime conference call still. A lot of it has been mitigated by those ongoing lawsuits in Texas.
But it has been 5 years. You'd think they'd have a Siri. If they meant to have a Siri API, they'd have it by now.
It's around.
And they may, just as Renee was kind of alluding to, I mean, an API is a very complicated thing to support.
Yeah, but 5 years, so, Alex.
I think they probably decided not to do that.
That's what they might guess by this point. No. Yeah.
It's easy when you're a little company because an API lets you scale quickly because it allows a lot of people to work on your product. Once you're a big company, an API means that you'll have an instant group of people that are excited about it, and an instant group of people that'll get really upset if you start changing the hooks.
Right. Well, look at Twitter. I mean, they were open until they got big, and then they said, never mind.
Well, it means, like, for example, you'll need to be able to set default apps, which is something that Apple is not letting people do right now.
Right.
Like, if you want to look for something in, like, if you want Siri to access, if you say open this up in Fantastical, that's easy. But if you just say add this to my calendar, maybe the calendar database can handle that. But there might be situations where you want to do something with a specific app, and you've got to be able to tell the computer to use the iOS to use one app over another. And then how do you set that? And if you install a new app, do you know that that's going to overwrite and become your new default when you talk to Siri? So there's a bunch of things that need to be, at least in Apple's philosophy of APIs, that need to be fleshed out before you can deploy that as a stable system.
Well, okay, but the risk is then that somebody else will do it. And that's what Viv is and others. I mean, if you don't do it, You might have all sorts of excellent excuses why you're not doing it, but if you don't do it, somebody else is going to do it.
Yeah. There are good and bad reasons to take any approach like that. Google Now is doing a pretty good job of letting third-party apps get their cards into that interface.
That you're talking about? Or
No. Well, Tap is another thing.
Well, that's right. They opened it up to other apps, didn't they?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So for instance, I'll get things for my Feedly. Right. Feedly feed appear in Google Now because it's aware that I'm interested in this one topic. And it seems to work okay, but I don't know exactly how many goats they had to slay in order to make that work as well as it does.
Right.
It's always good for consumers when there are so many competing platforms out there, because if Apple were ever so silly as to say, well, but you don't understand, is the difficulty of having a system like that that is open, but then you could just sort of like wait for the spokesperson to start talking and say, Google Now can do it and Alexa can do it, so they've solved the problem. So you're saying that you're not as clever as those people? Microphone.
Let's see what else. Anything else before we take a break and come back with your picks of the week? We don't have to talk about encryption for the first time in months. That's
Ooh.
Nice.
Ooh. We encrypted it so well, we can't get to it to talk about.
I think we can move on. I don't like to do all the rumors on the iPhone 7 until we get a little closer. They're still pretty much rumors.
It seems like every single device that's been rumored about, you could make the case that such a device is built and is functioning and is being considered. It's not until like June or July or even August that you start to say whatever is being talked about might actually be the thing that's on a container ship at this point somewhere in the ocean.
But aren't you people, I looked at these rumors and I was so bored. I mean, they're not, it's the same thing. It's a phone again. It's not a triangle. It's not shaped like a slice of pizza. I mean, I wish Apple would innovate again. No wonder they're doomed.
I want a circular phone.
I do. I want a star. Porthole phone. It'll match my Android Wear watch perfectly.
Well, there are some interesting things happening. Motorola is going to be announcing, Lenovo Moto is going to be announcing the next generation of the Moto X first week of June. And they did a little bit of.
Is it shaped like an X?
No, they did a cute little sneak on Mother's Day with pictures of what it looks like. And it looks like they've decided that the back plate is going to be either completely decorative or it will attach to a bank of pogo pins that are actually on the back of the phone itself. So that if you wanted to do something as simple as a battery pack or as complex as a much better camera or a network interface, that's something that could be done. Whether there's a market for that, I don't know, but it could be interesting.
Yeah. The chat room's telling me that Canadian banks are finally supporting Apple Pay.
This is truly. I added my.
I knew that because I've seen Renee's Instagram. it kind of threw me to see a picture of Renee's Apple Watch that did not have a gate information on it.
Ooh.
Yeah, no, you get great. Well, my bank of course, the bank that my credit card is with isn't supported yet because they're in the coming days. So five of the big banks added it. There's still three that are coming: BMO, TD, and I forget the last one, haven't added it yet, but they did tweet saying they will. But otherwise, we have credit card, debit card, and MasterCard support at five of the larger banks, including Royal Bank, which is really exciting.
We'll ask Steve Gibson. He's coming up on Security Now. Opera has announced that they have launched a VPN app for iOS, Opera VPN. But I remember that a couple of weeks ago, Opera announced that their browser would also have a built-in VPN. And then Steve said that's not really a VPN and doesn't give you the same protections that a VPN would give you. So I'll have to ask him about this. But it's interesting. It's it's free, right? It's a free VPN. Of course, Opera is now being acquired by a consortium of Chinese firms. So that's why you might want to inquire as to exactly what is it. They did buy a VPN company, Surf Easy, in the spring, and it might be that this is related to that. And as far as I can tell, it's free, right? Free and unlimited. There's no limit to the amount of bandwidth you can use. So I'm going to wait till Steve tells me it's a real VPN, and then I'll let you know. Let's take a break. When we come back, your picks of the week, gentlemen. Cue them up. First, I want to tell you why I'm looking so dapper today. It's Trunk Club.
Trunk Club. Actually, we just sent my trunk back. We saved, let's see, what I showed you my trunk a couple of weeks ago. We saved the polo shirt, a couple of slacks, and nice chinos, and the dress slacks, a pair of shoes, I think, and, oh, those swim trunks. I love some nice. So here's what Trunk Club is. It's so great. And I tell you, as geeks, I think we can use this. I'm not a big shopper. I don't like shopping for clothes. And maybe you do, but you don't have the time to do it. And then there are those of you like me who just really don't want to set foot in a store. But wouldn't it be nice for either one of those types to have your own personal stylist who would bring the clothes to you, would know your measurements, your likes, your dislikes, what you're trying to accomplish with your look, and then bring the clothes to you? That's what Trunk Club is. It's something I always wanted. I was so pleased when they launched this. Your personal stylist will talk to you, then put up on a website some suggestions that you'll get to say yay or nay to. They're picking from 80 top brands. I mean, these are really big brands. Then you get your trunk. It comes in the mail. All of this, by the way, you have paid nothing for. This is all free. You go through the clothes, try them on, see which ones you like, which ones you don't. Send them back. And it's only when your trunk arrives that they bill you for anything you keep. If you keep nothing, you pay nothing. And by the way, they have clubhouses in Dallas, New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, and D.C., so you can go there and work with your stylist in person as well. Now, this is not a subscription service. They will never send you a trunk unless you ask for one. Shipping is always free. You have 10 days to try on the clothes and decide what you want to keep and what to send back. Upgrade. I think you remember when I started using Trunk Club. My style got upgraded significantly. Upgrade your style. Premium clothes, expert advice, absolutely no work. And by the way, for men and women now, this is something, I think Lisa had something to do with this. She begged them, please, I want to do Trunk Club too. She too has her own personal stylist at Trunk Club. Trunk Club is backed by Nordstrom, by the way. I don't know if you knew that, but that's why they have such great quality of clothing and great customer service too. Everything Nordy's is famous for comes to your door. TrunkClub.com/MacBreak. They send you all this stuff. You talk to the stylist. It's all free until you keep something, and then you pay for what you keep and just for what you keep, and it's great. TrunkClub.com/MacBreak. I just sent my trunk back, or I would show it to you, but I'm getting a new one. Next time I'll show you my new stuff. It's kind of fun. Andy Iannacco, pick of the week.
I have a tip and a pick. I've been doing extensive home and office cleaning, which meant that I got out of my closet my iPod Hi-Fi and pulled out of a drawer a Chromecast audio that I hadn't been using. And I haven't been using the iPod Hi-Fi because everything I do streaming to. But hey, Chromecast audio costs $35. It's an audio only version of Chromecast. You plug it into your iPod Hi-Fi, and you wind up with a really good speaker that will stream from not just every Google app, but a lot of third party apps on iOS as well, and on the iPad. And it reminded me that the iPod Hi-Fi is a really good speaker, and it's too good to just be in a closet. So if you've got one in a closet somewhere that you're not doing anything with, by all means, haul it out for $35. You can turn it into something that will be your best kitchen speaker ever. Software pick is an app that I used a couple days ago called Find Any File. It's on a temple.org, TEMPEL.ORG. And it's sort of like a standalone app, shareware. So you use it for free. If you want to pay for it, $6. And it's sort of like, imagine what Spotlight would be if it were a standalone app and did not search within files. So it's for a very specific kind of purpose. When you really just want to get your hands on a certain file, it's a lot faster and a lot more direct, I think, than Spotlight, because it's not going to contaminate your search results with text files that happen to contain that certain word. And it's also a little bit more direct and obvious to me. When it finds search results, there's never any doubt as to where that file is. It will also search for hidden files. It will do. It will let you save searches. You don't have to remember what Spotlight search language is like, because you can actually just like you're doing a smart playlist on iTunes, say, please, I want the name to be this. I want it to start with this. I want it to be larger than this, but smaller than that. Even after all these years, I really have to go to a help page to remember what keywords to use to just construct that phrase in Spotlight to find a file that I want. Because oftentimes I'm just looking for what are the files that are clogging up my hard drive. Show me all video files that are greater than a gigabyte or greater than 512 megabytes. And for some reason, I find it's a lot quicker to get this done with this app. I actually wound up downloading and paying for it because there was a third-party app that I had installed that for some reason was still throwing up dialogue. So there was some sort of a kext or some sort of a system things after I deleted the application that was still causing it to send me notifications. And the only way, it was one of those things where I needed to delete it with extreme prejudice, in anger, in fury. And that involved basically, please show me every file of every kind, hidden or unhidden, that was created by this, that has the signature of this publisher. And so it found me all of these files that had been left behind after I had deleted I thought I deleted the app. And then only after forced deleting all that stuff, which was a snap inside the app, was able to get it done. If this were a $30 utility, I'd say, well, okay, just do Spotlight because there's just so much overlap. Again, it's shareware, so you can try it out for free pretty much forever. But for $6, it really fills in a gap that I think has been, for me personally, has been existing with search on the Mac for a while. I just like to be able to tab over to a standalone app that does nothing but find files by file name for me, no matter where they are, and let me do actions upon them in a way that, to me, is more natural than Spotlight, as good as Spotlight is.
Nice. Great. Couple of great tips. Thank you, Andy. Let's go to Renee Ritchie
for your tip of the week.
All right, so I'm going to try this. So my tip is a combination, actually. I've been experimenting with Facebook Live, and to spare my normal followers, because my account is private, I created a page called The Renee Ritchie to try it on. So I've been doing that. I'm going to do that now. But I went to the Apple Store, and I got this sort of Steadicam thing, because there's nothing worse than janky, shaky video when you're doing something. So I can press a button, and it turns to me, and I can explain to everybody watching that I'm on MacBreak now, and I'm showing this robot arm, and it feels like the first Iron Man movie, where it's not entirely under your control. And then I can just sort of flip to, oh, I'm knocking all these things down. But I can move this around, and it works really well to keep things just totally steady as I'm doing it. And I've done a whole tour of my studio with it. It's got a button on it. Let me hold it up so you can see more of it.
It's kind of interesting. We have the video, if we can, I don't know if we can switch to it on my Mac here. It's very it's kind of weirdly smooth because of the gimbal.
And you've got three different settings for it. So you can lock it on one of the axes and just let it go on the other axis. Or you can keep it in this mode, which just sort of wants to keep it totally steady no matter where you're going with it. And it's really great if you want to move around and do things. Because, again, I don't watch a lot of Facebook video because it's sort of horrible and it's so shaky that I can't really look at it. And with this, it's just rock steady. And
it looks stabilized. It looks like that thing... Are you still there? Oh, yeah, the video's frozen a little bit, but
the video is lagging a little bit. Yeah. But it's great because we did a whole bunch of product demos with it, and it's just rock solid no matter how much you're moving around or holding things. And it does take two rechargeable batteries. And the first time I did it, it would go the opposite. It's got a little joystick on it, so I can tilt it and make it move in different directions while I'm holding it. And you can reverse the direction on that like a flight stick. And I did that by accident and just kept going the wrong direction. And I sort of did say that I was going to get a dunce cap and get demoted to fire marshal. But after that, I got the hang of it, and now it works really, really well. And more people are doing sort of this live video stuff or just using their phones for photography, for video in general. And this, as much as the optical image stabilization and the new cinema stabilization works great, this just, if you're moving around and you want those steady shots, it looks really, really nice.
$300.
$300.
These are always expensive, so that sounds like a lot, but this is a complicated thing to do.
But Facebook video is free.
Yes.
So Facebook Live, Facebook Live is free.
Yeah, very nice.
And it's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
I can hit finish and it's done.
Yay. I don't know why it froze on my end. That's not unusual, however, is it? Are you going to keep this The Renee Ritchie account live, or?
I think so, because I my Facebook account is private, and I don't want to change that. I don't want to make it a public account, because I use it mostly for relatives and real-world friends.
So you should have a page.
Yeah, and this way I'm just going to leave the page there, and then I'll do a whole bunch. I've gotten to the point where I want to do some of the editorials, especially, you know, those things that make you righteously furious in video form.
Yes.
And YouTube is...
Because then you can rant.
Yeah, no, totally. And I think it's more dynamic, and you can get feedback from the audience and answer questions and stuff. And I like that. And it seems like it's more of a frontier while YouTube has become more stabilized and more entrenched, maybe. And this just, it seems really interesting to me.
Yeah, it looks pretty smooth. I can actually, because you stopped it, I can now go back and watch it from the beginning, which is a little disorienting. But it's really smooth. That's nice. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of it. And yeah. Again, it's like, remember, Leo, like back in the day, I'm streaming live from with Kik on my Nokia N95.
Uh-huh.
And it's sort of taken us years to get back to
that.
We've
come a long way, baby. That's the QIK program, not the Kik Messenger, K-I-K. Yep. Alex Lindsay, your pick of the week.
So it's kind of part pick, part tip. So I travel a lot. I know people have heard that every once in a while. And I have this problem that you get into another country and you have your adapter here and then you have this plug and then you don't have the adapter. You can't figure out what to do. So one of the things I carry around that is not very expensive is this cable. Now this cable, let me see if I can point it there. There's a... And technically, this is a C14 to a figure eight C7. It's 6 inches, so it doesn't take up a lot of room. Now, the reason that this is useful is because in your power adapter here, if you pull out the power, what you're actually looking at there is a figure eight input there, or technically a male figure eight. So you can take this little adapter here and plug it in like that. Now, if you, I've been known to take this and actually plug my TV, to plug the TV from the hotel room into my travel adapter, because that works too.
A lot of
TVs when you're in a hotel have this little figure eight C7.
So you steal it.
And so if you can't figure out, well, if you don't have an adapter,
right?
You don't have an adapter for it's clever. You gotta plug your computer in. You gotta do something about that. So you pull it out of the back of the TV and you can shove it into your adapter and it'll work just fine. Because the adapter will handle up, 110 to 240. So it'll do it anywhere in the world. It'll work as long as you have a TV with a figure eight. Now the reason that this one's useful, this little C15, is because pretty much every piece of computer equipment that has a power supply uses this C14. This is the C13 is the female, which is what we normally have, but this is the other side of that. So if you have this is what we plug into the back of our, a lot of our power supplies and everything else in our computers. And this is, of course, with a regular US plug, but you can go almost anywhere. And here is this is a European, European plug. And same thing, these C13s are everywhere. You can go to, a lot of times you can find them in the hotel room. If not, you can go to a hardware store and get them. So anyway, so if you're somewhere where you're not where tourists are and you need to get something to convert the power that you have, that you want to get the European or the South African or the whatever, you can, there you go. And that's actually the one I got.
$4.
And I'm really, $4.
And Keith512 says that's called a kettle lead to a radio lead.
Yes, I would call it a C14 to a C7.
Yeah, so, it does look like a kettle, and I guess I could see what you call it a radio.
This one's 1.5 feet, and I suggest the 6-inch one. The 6-inch one, there's another one that's 6 inches, which will save you like 40 cents, which is, important.
Well.
But the most important thing is that it becomes something you can throw in your bag.
You don't need a long one. You don't want a long one, actually.
Exactly. This just converts anything. You don't want it. There are ones that are a hard adapter. So they're, these two pieces like stuck together like this that stick out. You don't want that because that adds a lot of stress to your, to your connection. So a little bit of 3-inch or, just 3 inches here of cable will not put stress on your connection within your power supply. Mm. Anyway, I suggest this one, but you can throw it in your bag and it's not a big deal. There it is. Yeah. See, I saved you 20 cents. So,
Wow. I'm so impressed.
But you'd be surprised.
You care, Alex, don't you?
How, this is the kind of guy I am. But you'd be surprised at how often you get stuck somewhere. And, especially because I do a lot of production, literally every piece of equipment has this C13. And I just need to, if I need to plug something in, and also the connection to this will be a lot better. I mean, the connection from a cable like this into that converter will be a lot better than the weird thing that you bought at the travel store that's going to plug in, that's going to fall out, and all those other fun things. So it's a better connection.
By the way, that's 1/3500th of an Alex you saved us.
There you go. Yeah, it's better. I figured I'd give everybody a break.
and somebody's saying this pick is like 0.2 Alex's, 0.02 Alex's.
Don't worry. The next time I'm on, I'll
make up. I'll make it up.
I'll give you something expensive.
Because I got a $100 pick. Actually, we talked about it, and I finally got it. This is the Logitech Base, which is one of the first accessories that uses the Pogo plug on the iPad Pro to charge and hold. It's a stand. I have it right here for the iPad Pro. Now, one thing I know, I guess I knew, and I kind of wish they had made it a little bit more flexible in terms of angle. This is it. It's nice. It's well made. It's aluminum. The base of it is sticky, so your iPad's not going to go anywhere. And notice, on the back, you plug it into a lightning cable. Cable not included. And on the front, instead of a cable connector, you've got a those Pogo pins from the smart connector. So if you have an iPad Pro or of either size, because this will work with either size, you don't have to think about it. It's just got a magnet, and it just attaches, and there it is, and now it's charging. So I think that's a really nice, with the, you know, so for maybe like the bedside stand or something like that, but the angle is fixed, and it's a fairly shallow angle. So I just would raise that. So $100. I ordered it when we talked about it. What was it, 2 weeks ago? And it just came yesterday.
Looks like a great nightstand.
That's what it really is a nightstand, I think, you know? Or if you were watching TV or whatever, something like that. But, you know, as long as you understand that that's a fixed angle, that's kind of a nice thing to have. And I guess it's an okay angle for me sitting here. It's certainly good enough to use like this. I don't know if you'd want to draw. Maybe you would. Maybe it'd be okay. It feels a little shallower than I would have hoped.
Yeah. You know? Don't know about drawing, but yeah. The great thing if you're using it with an external keyboard. Yeah, well, maybe don't try to pull it off, I suppose.
It's very, well, no, it's, you know, it's got magnets, so it's very easy. You don't have to, like, fuss with it to get it to. Basically, it's like a wireless charger is what it's like.
It'll be super easy to see where the smart connector goes in the short term, because right now it's only really being used for the keyboard and now for this. But if Apple, as they tend to do, propagates this across their technologies and all sorts of battery packs and other things, like Andy mentioned with Motorola, will be super.
There
super
was
nice
a rumor that this would be the iPhone would have these Pogo plugs. And by the way, there's more you could put data and stuff over these, right?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, I think ground and power.
Yeah,
I'm thinking about things like nurses' workstations and monitors that are next to patients' bedstands, where you could just walk in with your tablet, put it in there. It collects all the data, so your interface, all the software. Then when you take it off again, you're taking all the data with you.
Yep.
Will it hold in portrait mode, Ethernet? Too?
Will it hold what?
Will it hold it in portrait mode? Obviously, it won't charge.
No, it won't charge, but it would hold it, yeah.
That's cool.
I was thinking of using these for iOS today, actually.
That's nice.
Yeah.
But I wonder what the limits is. Like, could you make a full dock out of that? Could the data connection support Ethernet and, you know, several other things at once?
Well, yeah, that would be really cool. But
just even basic, you basically get two lightning connectors, if it is able to handle the same data that the lightning.
I could, for instance, charge my pencil while I'm doing this.
Or have Ethernet going out that side and then have something else going out the other.
A headset when the 3.5 jack is on.
Yeah, well, let's see. I mean, I didn't even try this, but I presume there's no reason this wouldn't be live. Do you have one of these, Renee?
No, Daniel Bader reviewed it for us. Okay. He got the early.
I remember you told us about
it. Yeah, he liked it a lot.
Yeah.
He called it the closest thing to wireless charging you'd get for your iPad.
Yeah, as close as you're going to get on an iPhone or an iPad. Is it seeing the? Oh, it's pairing. It's just taking its time.
Yeah.
It's
in the widgets.
The widgets, not the notifications. Yeah, there it is. Oh, it's so low. I'm glad I'm charging it. Okay, there you go, everybody. Mac Break Weekly. Thank you, Renee Ritchie. iMore.com. Always great to have you on the show.
Can I tease something, Leo?
You have doubled your podcast output.
We're launching a new show. We actually have a staff on iMore now, which is something that Serenity and I are not used to, because it was the two of us for a long time. But now we have a lot of great people, and it's too much for one show. So we're going to have two shows. One is, I'll share the name now. We haven't announced it yet, but it's called Apple Talk.
Ooh.
And it's with Michael Gartenberg, Serenity Caldwell, and myself. First guest on the first show is John Gruber, and we're talking about the iPhone business.
Good.
So it's going to be deep industry analysis sort of and deep dives, almost always single topic focused. And then the iMore show, we're going to have Micah Sargent and Georgia Dow anchor that. And Serenity and I will guest in with some other people. And that's going to be more pop and fun and apps and accessories and all that kind of stuff.
Good. You can go to iMore.com and look in the podcast section under the hamburger menu and see all the shows, although the Apple Talk is not there yet.
No, it
will
should be
there soon. You got to do one first.
Yeah, well, the first one is in the can. It's just we haven't put it live yet.
Excellent. Thank you, Renee.
Thank you.
And Andy Inoko, Chicago Sun-Times. What are you working on these days?
Two pieces in the hopper, one in anticipation of Google I/O, the other one stuff that I feel like I got to wrap up before WWDC. I'm going to be one of those people who does an Apple Watch after 1 year piece. And so that should be hitting about next week or so.
Are you coming out for Google I/O?
No.
Okay. You could join us on our live coverage if you felt like
I would love to join you for live coverage.
All right. We'll make a date. Thank you, Andrew. Thank you also to Alex Lindsay. He's at the Pixel Corps. But here's the thing to do with Alex. You follow him on the Twitter, because that's how you'll know what he's up to. Alexlindsay, right?
Yep, that's the best way to do it. Mostly it's silly, but every once in a while, if we're doing something, if we've got something I can show, I pop it up there. That's usually the safest place to go.
Excellent. Thank you all for joining us. We do Mac Break Weekly on Tuesdays, 11 a.m. Pacific. That's 2 p.m. Eastern Time, 1800 UTC. You can watch live on twit.tv/live. You can download after the fact on twit.tv/MBW. You can subscribe in your favorite podcatcher. It doesn't have to be iTunes. Could be Marco's Overcast. Could be Pocket Cast. Could be the podcast app on your phone or your tablet. Could be one of them great Twit apps written by our friendly third-party developers who just do it out of the goodness of their heart. You can also join us in studio. Had some nice studio audience members here today. It's good to have you. Just email tickets at twit.tv if you'd like to join us here. We'll be back next week. I hope you will be too. But now, I'm sorry to say, it's time to get back to work because break time is over.